Welcome to today's webinar, How to Communicate Your Personal Brand for Maximum Impact and Success, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. My name is Kara Tyrone, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Malie Pompettit, founder and CEO of SOAR Community Network. Before we start, I have just a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded for our YouTube channel. Simply go to youtube.com and you can access over 375 past webinars, including this session. There are two audio options for today's session. You can listen via computer speakers or dial in to the conference number provided. It's important to note if you do have any audio difficulties, it can be caused by having too many software applications open at the same time. Questions are welcome today. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen as you have them. PowerPoint slides will also be emailed to you following the webinar. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area or visit the GoToWebinar support page. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter. Malie Pompettit is the founder and CEO of the SOAR Community Network, author, speaker, marketing strategist, podcaster, and the executive producer of Tea with Malie cable TV show. In 2015, Malie was selected as a Belief Team Community Partner through Values Partnership for the Oprah Winfrey's own network, Belief Initiative. She has over 18 years of marketing, sales, and business development experience. Malie also ran a financial services practice for 7 years, where she created and implemented risk management strategies for hundreds of clients. Malie is a community champion for several local nonprofits. She is the co-founder of the Young Professional Leadership Group and the co-host of Creative Entrepreneur Buzz podcast, named New and Noteworthy and What's Hot on iTunes in 2014. A Million Fireflies is Malie's memoir about her voyage from war-torn Laos to America. She is also the co-author of Seen and Sustained, Best Practices in Communication that Increase the Visibility of Small and Diverse Businesses, a professional workbook written with Akia Garnett, Jane Lovas, and Tanisha Bradshaw. She has shared her insights at the Library of Congress, Smithsonian, University of Maryland, George Mason University, SAIC, and other national venues. Advisor of Today Magazine, Asian Fortune Newspaper, WJLA DC, Radio Free Asia, WHUR Radio, Voice of America, Intentful Magazine, and numerous blog talk radio programs have featured her work and journey. Malie, thank you so much for your time today, and now I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you so much for having me. Thanks for your team for hosting such a webinar for all the alums, and I welcome you all. Without further ado, I would like to just dive in because we have a lot to cover and I do want to leave room for the Q&A at the end. So today what we're going to focus on is how to communicate your personal brand so that you can maximize your impact and success in the business world. And because I know that we have such a diverse group of folks on this webinar, we're going to focus on the personal brand, generally speaking, in the business world, and we'll also talk about what that means for independent brands as well as businesses and business owners. So thank you again. My name is Malie Pompettit. I am the CEO and founder of the SOAR Community Network, and who we are is we are a virtual marketing and IT growth strategist department for growing businesses. Today, we're going to focus on what is personal branding. And personal branding is, personal branding, what is it? Well, definitely what it is not is just self-promotion and simply being all over social media. It's dedicating actual time to define yourself as a leader and your characteristics and your attributes, unique attributes, and how you want to be known both in and out of the workplace. It's creating an image for yourself, for how you want to be viewed by whether it's your employers or employees, customers, industry peers, and what you represent to your social network, and that's both online as well as your social networks in the, quote, real world. It's also a never-ending journey of self-discovery. You are allowed with your personal branding to change and morph and rediscover yourself. But ultimately, you want your core values to remain consistent and in alignment throughout all of the different platforms and ways in which you share your brand. It's very important to have that authentic communication about your values and to be consistent. Why is personal branding important for business? Well, it clearly showcases your best self. Once you uncover what that actually looks like, feels like, and represents, what is your best self? Who is your best self? Your personal brand will become that vivid indication for the best that you have to offer the world. It reflects your performance and your contributions, the value that you offer to your employer or employee or employees. This is what they will expect from you. And again, I'll say consistently. It also helps you stand out. Personal branding helps you clearly stand apart from others that are possibly competing for the same jobs or maybe marketing to similar demographic of clients or prospects. Personal branding can attract others based on your similar core values. So the most important thing to do with branding is to uncover what those core values are. So then you'll be able to articulate that and message that to the community in which you wish to impact and serve. The other thing to remember about standing out with your personal brand is employers, potential partners, potential consumers will use social media and look for your brand identity and help decide whether to hire or fire you, to bring you on board as a team member, a strategic partner, to invest in your company or brand, or to invest in you. So that's really something to consider. And permission to show up as you are. What does that really mean? Well, once you stake a claim on your brand and you start messaging it and putting it out there in the world, you're really not expected to apologize. You've uncovered what your brand is, you're staking a claim to it, you're putting it out there, and you're not going to be sorry for what you stand for, what you represent. And there's a freedom in that for a lot of branders who are out there thinking, well, what's in it for me? It does give you a sense of freedom to show up as you are. The other great thing about branding is, well, to know the psychology behind connection and emotional connection. Human beings buy from other human beings. So if you own a business or if you have a personal brand and want to offer, whether you're a solopreneur or a musician, artist, anything of that nature, consumers as well as potential clients really want to know that there is a person, a human being, and a community of people to connect with that is not just represented by a logo and it's not just stale, but it's dynamic. Why is personal branding important? Continued. Personal branding is really not just what you look like online. It's what people think of you when you're at a networking event. It's what employers or recruiters might really consider when they start talking to you and presenting you to possibilities and opportunities. It's what your friends say about you. It's how you show up in the world. And with today's technology and online platforms, it definitely gives you a presence whether you like it on social media. Credibility through action is also why personal branding is important. You build credibility not just through your words and the messaging, but how you show up. If you're living your personal brand and you keep your brand promise at every angle you can possibly think of, your target market will automatically really go on that path of choosing you as a credible source or resource. Consistency in brand message is when sharing online elevates that social proof. And for a lot of folks who know what social proof is, and for those who might not know what social proof is really your presence online that allows people to really believe whether you're a viable, let's say, business or brand. It's the reviews, it's the number of likes and shares, it's the kind of tribe that you inspire to follow your work and your brand. And people do care about that, and we'll talk about that a little later in the presentation. It helps you solidify your niche. You have a unique combination of work experiences, life experiences, and personal characteristics that create that foundation, and it determines your niche. It helps people really place you somewhere. And in this, in the human mind, we need to have categories of where we place people and things, and it helps us process better. It helps to build your tribe. Building a strong personal brand really helps that interaction with the people you wish to communicate with. It makes who you are very clear. You're consistently putting out there your core values, what you want to offer to the world, and it allows people to have a familiarity with you. It helps to clearly get that message to others, and most importantly, helps others, once you are able to clearly articulate your brand, helps others share you with their network. And that trust, that tribal community experience, allows a lot of brands to elevate above and beyond other brands, a very important thing to consider. And joy. Who wants joy, right? Joy in knowing who you are in the world. A benefit of having your personal brand defined is that when you have a clear understanding of who you are, what you are great at, what you're passionate about, who you want to communicate with and work with, and also how you want to share and showcase your talents, you also know that you don't necessarily have to be it all, and it helps you define what it is that you really want and don't want out of life. This is a really important point to make. Branding, whether it's professional branding or personal branding, happens automatically. So why not design it with intention? You have a brand whether you really realize it or not. You show up at a networking event, you go to the grocery store, you pick up the phone, and depending on the tone of your voice, and right now you're not seeing me, but the way that I'm speaking and communicating with you, you're already making an assumption of who I am and what possibly I might represent and stand for. And that's really important to understand if what you're putting out there is really received the way you intend it to be received. And the only way to do that is to go through this process of really uncovering what is your brand and how is that being translated out into the real world. So if you haven't thought much about the personal brand of you, and you haven't really considered possibly what your colleagues might be thinking every day that you go to work, or your strategic partners, or your leaders inside your organizations, what are they defaulting to that they're not hearing from you and they're making to be true about you? To know yourself is to brand with authenticity. We hear that word a lot, authenticity, and I think it's important that it's become a popular word because it's what people, human beings, really want at the end of the day. They want to know that you're real. They want to trust that the person that they're speaking to or the brand that they're trying to get involved with or possibly go in partnership with is authentic, real, truly cares about the things they care about. So what's important about personal branding is each of us, if we take the time to know ourselves, who we really are, what we stand for, what our natural characteristics are and our tendencies as a leader, as a community supporter, whatever blank category, you want to find out, well, am I able to communicate what I stand for? And am I able to do it in a way that's clear for me first and it's easy to get out there to others? When you're out of touch with who you are or in a place where you're not quite sure what direction you want to go, and that's okay too, it's all about uncovering it, it makes it hard for you to really state that claim of what you stand for, and so you're going to be more susceptible to other people defining who you are and your brand and making assumptions. What does it take to build your personal brand? When I work with businesses and independent brands, a lot of times we have to do the heart-based work first before we start working on crafting the right message and creating the right look and feel for a logo or what the website content is going to say and who it's going to speak to. We spend a lot of time really bringing it back down to the core of even coaching to a certain degree before we even take your business and your brand to market. And some of the questions that we go through with our clients and our leaders and our partners in our mastermind groups is spending time and doing this more often than just one time every 5 years to figure out who we really are in this moment in time, what we stand for, and what our current goal is and our near future goal is. And so I want to share a few questions that really help to uncover these attributes that will help you solidify your brand look and feel. The first thing is to uncover needs, okay? What do you need and want out of life? And if you want to specifically work on your personal brand inside the business world, you can substitute the word life and you can put the word business or career or project goal. What do you need and want out of this experience? Next is values. The core principles, those are the values, are the set of standards that really determine your choices, why you do what you do, your actions, how you process information and project that into the world with your attitudes, and down to the decisions that you make. What are the motivating factors behind that? What are those core values that basically make you operate the way that you do? It's important to write those down. And if some of the things that you reveal are not necessarily positive, it's okay, because we can turn those negative characteristics or what you might think to be flaws and put a positive spin on it, because we might need that and use that to help elevate what makes you unique and powerful. Next is to uncover your interests and your passions. What intrigues and motivates you? How do you spend your time? What makes you feel happy and in harmony with life? And for those in the world that are nurturers and natural givers, it's very hard to spend time thinking about what we want and what motivates us. A lot of times we're operating by default, and I can speak from personal experience because I'm a giver and a natural helper and want to basically change and save the world. It could be powerful, and it could also be very daunting. But it's important to really center self and take the time to understand what motivates you and at the core, and really define that. Answer those questions and see what reveals itself to you in this process. Next is knowing your mission. And some of the questions that will help uncover this, and again, this is very high level, but what are you all about? What do you stand for? What do you want to do with your life? And until you figure that out for yourself, it's going to be very difficult to help others figure that out or inspire others to uncover the same in themselves. And when I say the same, I mean their mission. Next is to think of vision. What do you envision your life to look like? If you accomplish your mission, how would you feel? And it's really important to tap into the feeling of all this. I mean, a lot of the work in the branding world is part science and part art. It's the heart side, and it's also the process analytical side. And they really do have to work together. Where would you be if you were able to accomplish your mission? And who would you have around you? What does it look like? What's the environment? What's the tone? And a lot of times I get questions about, well, what's the difference between a vision and a mission? And one simple way to help really clarify that is to put the A-R-Y behind the words. And so for a visionary, it's really this big picture, the kind of big impact you want to have in your business, in your life, in your community. And when you think of missionary, it's the actions, it's the things you have to do or want to do and need to do in order to manifest those goals that you set forth. And I hope that helps. Next is to identify key strengths. Make note of certain abilities that allow you to produce the positive outcomes that are consistent and over time and throughout your life. This will help you reveal those key strengths, what has been happening throughout your life over time that's allowed for positive outcomes over and over again. And you want to think about the strengths as your key attributes. You may be a wonderful communicator and listener. Your strengths may be that you just naturally make people laugh, and you love to joke, and you love to see the positive things in life. Your strengths may be that you pay careful attention to detail. Next is your uniqueness. Now, I think uniqueness encompasses all of these things that we're discussing, but uniqueness is, when you try to uncover it, it's really the qualities that make you different and stand out and make people pause to ask you more questions. It's very difficult sometimes to uncover your uniqueness and even your strengths, because if it is truly unique to you and if it is truly a gift, it's innate within us. So we may not be able to identify it right away. So we'll have to look at communities of friends, trusted advisors, mentors, to really help them communicate to us over time what have we been consistent about and how do we show up that makes us special and unique. Next is experience. Experience can encompass a lot of things. It can mean your cultural upbringing. It can mean the environment and the zip code in which you grew up. It can mean your educational background, work experiences, the type of training that you've had, and projects that you've worked on. Many, many things. So the most important thing is to highlight all of the experiences that really taught you something, whether they at the time might have felt negative or challenging, and as well as those amazing experiences that when you look back, it just puts a smile on your face and you feel great about your contributions to that particular project or experience or opportunity. Next is to get the feedback. I touched upon it a little bit earlier when I spoke about uniqueness. Getting those close friends and advisors and colleagues, and even to a certain degree, family members. Because sometimes family members, they love you, but they're also much more open to being honest and brutal with their feedback. And that's actually a good thing, because we want to really be able to look at the overall picture of what we stand for, not just based on what we want to see and hear, but based on what might actually be happening. It's really important to truly be open to feedback and to be able to receive it without going on the defense, because once that defense goes up, it's very hard to go back and do an analysis on what might actually be the truth, in quotes, out there about you that's not intentional. And you'll also uncover the truths that you were hoping exuded outside of, you know, just in your mind and in your body, but it actually is energetically flowing out into the world in a very positive way. And once you uncover all this, it makes it much better to have a branding conversation and to map it out. And then identifying your target market and your audience. Who do you really, really want to impact in the world? Where do you want to make the most difference? How will you create this personal brand that truly engages the type of people that you want to reach and helps them to clearly understand what you represent so they can go out and share it and be your advocates and vouch for your credibility and give you social proof, and the list goes on and on. Next, I want to talk about brand authenticity. Why is it so important to be authentic? Well, lots of studies and surveys and Psychology Today, which I read a lot of articles from, talk about the more virtual our lives become, the more our human desires hunger for something that's genuine, a true connection. And some of the research I wanted to share, according to a recent Journal of Business study, consumers see three dimensions of brand authenticity. What does brand authenticity to them mean? And overall, the three dimensions are heritage, so your cultural background, where you came from, your history, the sincerity in which you present yourself and your brand to the world, and the absolute commitment you have for quality, for service, for being the best you can be, for offering the best products, for being bleeding edge and innovative. Also, In this research, we found that 30% of millennials say that they are cynical about the way that brands market to them. And seeing as though right now the millennials are the largest consumer market for those that care about consumerism and those numbers, it's important for us to consider what's happening in the mindset of our consumers. Now, obviously, these numbers only focus on millennials, but you'll see similar studies for other generational groups. And really important to note that in the UK and US, those numbers are greater than 40%. So almost half the millennial population surveyed say that they really don't trust the way that brands are representing themselves. 91% of consumers rate honest communication about products and services as truly the most important, honest communication. And that's important for those that are truly looking for ways to use social media or in the world of marketing already, or have companies or brands that are using communication tools. How are you communicating in a way that really, to the audience, your target audience, compels them to believe and trust you? And secondly, the other important criteria that we have to consider is trustworthiness and authenticity, which is the whole cusp of personal branding. Consistency in messaging, consistency in your look and feel, consistency in what you're doing in the world through your actions is really an important element to successful branding. If those aren't consistent, the messages are all over the place, you know, you're changing your core values one day, making a decision, and then backtracking the next day, the public and your general audience that you're trying to reach might get confused. And with all the information out there in the world, with so much content available, you want to avoid confusing the public because they're just going to go find the information or your products and service somewhere else. The benefits of a consistent branding for your business or for those that are in corporate America, thinking about your career, where do you want to stand, what do you want to represent in who you are and your experience and your attributes? Well, it definitely helps you to differentiate yourself and your business. And we talked about standing out. Again, it keeps showing up and it's really important because that's really the key to successful branding, whether it's your personal brand or your business brand. It also, consistency in branding also gives you a chance to emotionally connect with a new audience. And an audience meaning new people you get to meet. And if it's a live interaction or a networking event, or just the first meeting you're experiencing for a project, it gives that emotional connection. Okay, well, if I've researched you before you showed up to this meeting, and when you show up you're speaking the same language, then I trust that. It elevates your business by giving it a personality. When I shared about humans wanting to buy from humans and emotionally wanting to be involved in your world and sharing those core values, it really is essential to identifying someone that's like-minded to connect with. And it's all about the feeling, how your brand and what you stand for makes others feel about you. Effectively, it delivers and reinforces your key messages. Sometimes, if you do an amazing job in branding, actually not sometimes, oftentimes, if not always, you may not necessarily have to repeat your tagline over and over and over again, or your messages over and over and over again, because the moment they see your logo or you show up in a room, it's just by default, they already know what you stand for, and that would be the ideal branding goal. Consistency also drives authority and trust in your community and in your industry. For those that are seeking to be industry leaders, especially in industries that are very saturated with others in your profession. For many years when I was in financial services and I had my practice and I ran that practice for 7 years, it was quite interesting to figure out unique ways to stand out. And to the point where I was representing a larger corporation, I really thought about this with intention. How am I different from all the other financial reps out there in the world. And I began to craft my own messaging and marketing content, which then I pitched to the home office, and sometimes it took months and months for them to approve it because of compliance issues, but it was very important to me that my unique message and voice was heard. I was serving a lot of first-generation, second-generation immigrant families in the Washington, D.C. area. I'm a child refugee of war myself, and I really wanted to serve a community that could relate to me and I could relate to. And there was no marketing or branding content that really spoke to that community. And that was an intention on my part, and it really helped to solidify my success in the financial practice. So those types of things we have to think about. How do we think outside the box when it comes to taking responsibility for our brand? Consistency also drives consumers to be more loyal and to also truly advocate for us and go out there and be brand loyal and constantly want to just choose us, send more people to us, and to trust that we're going to take care of them and the people that they love and care about. And consistency also helps with positioning your brand correctly. It helps you achieve better jobs and roles and higher prices for your products and services because, again, that social proof also provides a perception, and if we do it right, that perception is truly the reality of the quality of person you are, services you offer, and products that you actually have created and built. And that quality will elevate your chances, again, for being hired, for getting that promotion you wanted, and to also be able to have consumers and clients value your experience and your work and pay for that. Brand exposure and reach. Well, why is this important? Once you identify your personal brand and your business brand, you want to now be able to share it in places that make sense for your audience, the target ideal audience, which brings up a really good point. You can have an amazing brand, but if we haven't thought about who we're trying to impact and what community we want to reach, that brand might not necessarily have any traction if we're mistargeting who we want to serve. It may not be important to the community, to a specific community or audience, if we haven't really thought about what messages are going to reach which audience and why is that important and how is that going to move your work and their community and their needs forward. The one thing about today with technology and the way that we're able to reach, it's really important for us to consider that as the moment that you create a brand and you put it online, you are global now. We couldn't say that 15, 20 years ago as easily as we can today, but literally anyone in the global market can find you once you're online. And here are some of the ways in which you can take your brand and reach a mass audience and market. And I'm going to touch upon this a little bit because in the work that we do, a lot of our customers and clients come to us and they're unknown brands. We love working with the growing businesses or independent brands. And the issue is, well, how do I get my message, my brand, the passion that I have and the vision that I have for X, Y, and Z to really make an impact in the community and to attract potential customers, clients, what have you. And today it's much easier to get the type of press and media that we weren't able to get exposed to before. A lot of things that we have to consider is, you know, the PR and media world. It used to be that you have to hire a huge or large agency to get you the number of viewers and listeners. Well, today you have local television programs, you have online networks that really allow you to upload your video productions to millions and millions of potential subscribers and users on that network. Local news, because there's a lot of different online publications and not just offline and tangible physical papers. You have a lot of editors who want great content. Blog talk radio stations and audio podcasts, my goodness, there's hundreds of thousands, if not now millions, of possible programs where people are always looking for experts. And we spend a lot of time going to these blog talk radio programs, audio podcast producers, video podcast producers, and these networks, and we pitch our clients there because, you know, the exposure to millions, does it matter if it's in your local community? Maybe so if you're a retailer and you're focused on really being local. But for a lot of, let's say, consultants or practices that really want to expand, you really just want to get your message to as many people as possible. And that's really want to open all of our minds to the possibilities that there are so many different amazing, unique ways now to get your message to market. And we can't limit ourselves to the traditional ways. We have to really think outside the box and be creative and truly impact the people we want to serve. This is going to be a little bit focused on those business owners out there or independent brands, but for us as corporate, let's say, leaders, community advocates, civic leaders out there that want to brand ourselves, these are still very relevant to why it's important to consider the trends and what people really want in order to truly trust your brand and share your brand. Consumers, followers, fans, they want transparency. The more honest and open you are with your customers, your clients, your partners, and all aspects of your business, the more that you can show your team doing some great things and communicating as if, you know, you have a fun networking events that you host, community events that you do, the more you share that, the more that energy and spirit of your company comes to life. And the more that they'll be able to feel like that trust is there. Once the trust is there, it's very easy to be loyal. Next is your care and your concern for humanity. You might have the biggest heart and the greatest intention, but if you're not vocalizing that or sharing that or putting that as a part of your brand, it's very hard for people to know that that's really what's important to you. And you might get overlooked because the global consumers these days want to know that you care about something besides just being successful and profitable. Of course, those are all important, but what do you really do once you get to success, and how are you sharing your significance with the world in a positive way? So what they want is being able to speak, you to speak to them as if you were speaking face to face, as if you were able to truly have that eye-to-eye connection. This is what we are and what we stand for. They also care so much about customer service, and not necessarily just customer service, but the customer experience. How do you make them feel from beginning to end? The moment they hear about you as a person or brand to the end of the project or experience with you, and on to the next evolution of your relationship, right? So that's really important. That's going to be a key factor in the trends of brands and being able to focus how do we stand apart from others in how we make our customers and clients and partners feel. The next thing is simplicity. Okay? Keep it as simple and as succinct as possible. That's why the consistency in messaging is so important. Straightforward, to the point, bullet points. You don't necessarily have to write 3 to 10 paragraphs when you post on social media. That's why Twitter is so popular. That's why Instagram is so popular. Give me an image. Give me a few words. Tell your story in a powerful way. But don't waste my time because I don't have time to read. And so that's really the popularity of certain social media sites. It's really based upon the psychology of what people desire and want and how they connect these days. The next thing is personalization. A lot of people have in sales and marketing for many years are familiar with this segmentation, you know, targeting your demographics. But even on social with your brand, it's more important than ever with all the analytical tools as well as the data collection that's happening, is once you take that data and you start to pay attention to it, we need to analyze it and we need to use that to help us reach the people we really want to reach, create the change we wish just to see, and be able to know exactly what information is valuable to those that you wish to impact and serve, because it really does come down to what's in it for them, and to know exactly what the right time is. If you're on social media, or if you're picking a platform to share your audio or video podcast to, where are your target audience listeners tapping into? Which networks? And at what time of day does it make sense for them to actually have time to hear your message? All important for maximum impact and reach. Technology. Technology is so important to learn about, the different applications that are out there, and so also if you need to hire other technology specialists who can help so that you can focus on your passion and your purpose and your vision and your mission for your life and for your business. Okay, technology these days, it's typically there, and of course we have glitches here and there, but typically there to make it easy for our customers, our prospects, our friends to truly engage, communicate, have that response time that makes it feel real time even though we're not in front of each other. And invite your audience to participate. Encourage them to submit a podcast or a post, I'm sorry, a blog post, share their photos, create story contests, keep it relevant to what matters to your audience, and ask questions on social media. Use hashtags. Those are important because that's how people search for information, with millions and millions and millions of photos and videos being shared every day. How do you find what's important to you in the world of online content delivery? So use what is available and learn what's necessary to really get your brand out to market. I wanted to share a couple of things that really opened my eyes to how we look at our business and truly listen to what the consumers and our clients really want. And if you look here, I mean, how do online customers customer reviews really affect the opinion of local businesses? And I share this one because it really can spread across to personal brands and who you are. And if you look here, positive customer reviews make me trust a business more. And in 2014, it was at 72%. When you compare it to what reviews, if the reviews influence decisions to buy or not, and also if the reviews really don't matter at all. And there's a significant difference between what reviews actually allow to happen in the minds of consumers. And if the reviews are important and it helps them make the buying decisions, let's take a look at our reviews and our testimonials and what's out there that's being said about us. The other thing to consider is, really importantly, are we aware of what our brand is looking like out there? Where are we being found? Who is sharing us? And are they sharing it for positive reasons or are they sharing it for negative reasons? This is important, especially for those that who are online and using social media as a way to reach new audiences, new potential prospects, what have you. The top eight ways that millennials, and I'm using millennials because these are the most recent graphs that I found, how the top eight ways millennials advocate for brands that they love. I mean, this is the ideal when someone else that may have never met you physically is talking about you, and it might even be happening across the globe. But likes on Facebook is the top on this particular graph. So if you are on Facebook, are you utilizing it? And if you're on Facebook, do you have a public business or public figure page that you really can strategize and allow for your personal brand and business brand to elevate and to be seen? Because that's really where you can expand your reach. Advocacy, you know, being able to really, really be the ambassador and taking the initiative to go out there and say, this is a great company. Other ways that they can advocate for brands is to actually shop and use the, you know, going in store and being a consumer, truly physically being a consumer. And then the list goes on, buying online, being proud owners of something, and really loving the quality of the product and being able to speak on that. Collecting email subscribers or becoming an email subscriber is a great indicator that people really care about getting information from you. Our job is, once someone subscribed to us, is to provide the consistent quality that made them hopeful enough to get that information to subscribe. Okay. The same thing for those that are interested in podcasting or having your own blog talk radio or however you're messaging your brand is, the moment people subscribe or download, they're choosing to do so. And they could choose so many other programs, but they're choosing you. So why are they choosing you? What is your brand really emitting out there that is bringing those folks to the table? And how do you continue to spread that brand to like-minded folks? Okay? So that just gives you a sense there. And then just loyalty programs and such, as well as followership on Twitter, is other ways that people are advocating for their brands, brands that they trust and love. And then how do they find brands? This is also as equally important. Well, Facebook is number one again. They search Facebook to see if you're viable, you exist, you're there. Friends and family, of course, we all default to, well, who do you know who can do X, Y, and Z? Who's the best at X, Y, and Z? And then television commercials, 36% people are still watching television commercials. They're not as high on the list as they were several years ago with all these different social media platforms, but it's still a viable way for brands to reach the market. And then also being able to have a store to go to. Brand websites are next. Online ads are still viable. Twitter is next, and then other social media networks and blogs and magazine ads. So this kind of gives you a sense, if you're looking to promote your brand, where do you want to invest and how much do you want to invest? And before even deciding that, because this particular graph talks about millennials, but depending on your target demographic, you want to be able to find information that's going to allow you to choose the right mediums. So how do you communicate your brand in powerful ways? Well, it's important to have recommendations and reviews and testimonials listed online somewhere, because that's really where people search. And they are, as we mentioned, truly seeking credibility and social proof in their decision-making process. It's also important to truly become a storyteller. Instead of just outputting information, you really want to be able to tell the story. You want it to be engaging. You want to share a journey. You want to connect emotionally. And talk about those life lessons. And if it's not just about your personal brand, but your business brand, talk about the everyday life of your team and make it so that there's human beings working and people can resonate with that. Use humor if you have to. Use shock factor if you have to, but make it engaging and interesting. More and more these days, you can become a video or blog star. A lot of people have become YouTube superstars, for instance, and bloggers, a lot of them also have amazing, amazing advertisers, big dollars, because they're sharing their journey and they're using what's available to show up in the world and be found. So how do we become creative and pick the right platform for us to get our message out there? Lead fund meetings and webinars. You know, being able to connect with so many of you out there in the world without even seeing you, it's such a fun way to connect with you and share something that I'm passionate about and I love, and also gift the experience of knowing that hopefully what I'm sharing is beneficial in some way to your everyday life to help you become successful. Know your audience. Know who it is that you really want and care about to serve, to impact, and to communicate with. Use the right tools and platforms to reach the ideal audience. There's a lot of different tools, a lot of different platforms. What's right for you? What's innate that feels natural for you? And where, again, is your audience? You don't have to do it all. You just have to do it in a way that really makes sense for your business and your goals. The next thing is to be engaging. We mentioned that as well. Show the emotional side. Make it fun. It's important to take a stand. A lot of times when you're out there in the market and there's so many people in your industry, and when people don't know what you really stand for and what you represent, it's truly difficult for them to really trust that they can share you in a unique and exciting way. Because if you're not above par with any, if you're the same as everybody else, it's very hard for them to share you and be excited about that. And then take action. Take action and show your results. Talk about your accolades from time to time. Let people know that you really stand by what you say and what you share out there. You actually do the things that you are inspiring others to do. And this is what helps to create brand loyalty. All right. Well, I know that I wanted to leave some time for Q&A, and I just wanted to share with you, for those that are in Washington, D.C. area, if you are around and you're interested, the SOAR Community Network is hosting a summit to help advance legacy-driven leaders and really help refine what do you stand for as a leader, what is your personal brand, and bring the right-brained and left-brained professional civic leaders and business leaders together to truly talk about how do you move from success to significance. And so I invite you to join us if you can. To learn more, please contact us and be happy to provide you with more details and information. And for our website to contact me, you can go to soarcommunitynetwork.com. And this is also my contact information and our team. So I thank you so much for taking part in this webinar, a very broad overview of branding and why it's important in the business world. And certainly for those that are interested in having a longer dialogue, I'm happy to speak with you and just reach out. I'm very accessible. Thank you so much.
Lily, thank you so much for that presentation. It was fantastic. We're going to go ahead and get started with the questions as we have several for you here. The first being, why is a personal brand necessary if I have a business? Shouldn't I be focusing on building the business brand instead of the personal brand?
You know, it's very interesting. When we studied the top brands out there, and we talk about personal brands, when you look at the number of followers and the number of fans and loyal advocates, when you take a look at their Twitter accounts or their Facebook accounts and you see their personal brand versus their business brand, you see a significant difference in the number of followers in the personal brand page. And I can give you a prime example from myself. The SOAR Community Network business page on Facebook was launched just last year because we rebranded the company to a new name, and we have maybe 1,500, the last time I checked, was a little over 1,500 likes on our SOAR Community Network business page. Now you go to my Mali Pompadith public figure page, and we have over 8,000 likes, and I launched that pretty much at the same time. So I think it's really important that if you are branding your business as a visionary or leader, or even someone who's inside the organization that's leading a team, it's important that people know what you stand for, that you're the expert in something. And it's really important that if that's what's happening in social psychology and marketing psychology, why not have it out there and lead with the personal brand, because that's what people are gravitating toward, and let the personal brand lead people to the business. So we have to work with what's out there for us and take a look at what's happening with human psychology.
Great. Thank you, Molly. Another question we have here has to do with others' perception of our personal brand, in that many times it can be different from what we may think other people see. So do you have any recommendations on how we can move forward with getting anonymous feedback from colleagues or friends on how they perceive our brands? And what personal strengths and weaknesses they see in us.
Yes. And oftentimes, if we're a new brand and we're kind of at this branding concept of very early stages, it is going to be very difficult to get a feedback from, let's say, the general public, right? Honest feedback. So what I would recommend, if that is the case, is to truly, like we mentioned in the presentation, look at your centers of influence, your strongest advocates, even close friends who are familiar or colleagues that are familiar peers with your industry and what you're trying to do and offer to the world. And set up some type of either focus group or even just a very basic survey that just ask them point blank, honestly, and this is what I had to do for my personal brand, is, you know, what words come to mind when you think of my personal brand? What do I project into the world? And of course, your closest friends and advocates and centers of influence know what the intention is for this exercise, so they're not going to think you're pretentious for asking. You really want to be able to craft something that's meaningful and do it right. So I would start there. In terms of perception, we're always going to have a little bit of that if we haven't really taken the time to refine and maybe even redefine our target audience and who we truly wish to speak to. When you first start branding yourself and putting it out there and you don't have really an idea of what target market is truly yours to hone in on, you're going to get some mixed reviews because it may not be hitting the exact right segment of the market that's going to resonate with your brand. So you're going to get some negative feedback. That shouldn't hold you back. You just have to investigate a little further and do more analysis. Well, why am I getting negative feedback about my brand here in this, quote, category of folks and positive and beautiful things being said here? And typically, with that analysis, you'll be able to uncover maybe it's a misdirection of not just the messaging and brand, but the target audience.
Great. Thank you so much, Malie. Another question. What questions should I ask myself when answering the question, what do I stand for?
That's a great question. Well, I think it comes down to looking objectively, if this is even possible. That's why it's good to go to either get coaching or mentorship or go to some type of group exercise where you really can take the time to discern this. You look at the big picture of your life and all the experiences, and there's an exercise that I have that really allows you to sit down and write the things that have happened in your life, positive, negative, impactful, and as the moment that you start to put it down, either on paper or even record it, however you operate, you'll be able to start to see overarching themes of consistency and repeating patterns of either behavior or reactions to certain types of incidents happening in life, the things that you've done that have really, to those around you, made a difference in their lives. And once you can start mapping, it's truly a mapping process, and we have what's called a vision and mission mapping process. To go through this, and again, it is hard work, but it is important to do it, but to go through this is really this self-discovery phase of what is the overarching theme, what's consistent, that allows me to tap into, I keep reacting this certain way, or this kind of experience continues to make me happy and blissful and joyful, and this type of community service or topic really resonates with me to the core, where I get truly emotional, I'm passionate and powered up by it. Only through that exercise with intention can those things be revealed. And it takes time. But it's really about the things that matter to you, what you stand for, really, how do I make the most impact in the world? And sometimes we have to step outside of ourselves to really see the impact we've been able to, through all of our lives, positively impact our community.
Malie, thank you so much for all the time that you've given Georgetown today, and I want to thank everyone that's been on this call for the webinar. And just as a reminder, we will be sending out the slide deck from the presentation either this afternoon or tomorrow morning, and you can access the recording of this presentation should you want to watch again by early to mid next week. So wishing everyone a happy St. Patrick's Day, and Malie, again, thank you so much, and I hope everyone has a great rest of the afternoon.
Thank you.